tonight our bedtime story is going to be the Sonnets of Shakespeare. So sit back and relax. Take some deep and soothing breaths and let me read you to sleep. Sonnets to the only begetter of these ensuing sonnets, Mr. W.H., all happiness and that eternity promised by our ever-living poet, wisheth the well-wishing adventurer in setting forth. Sonnet 1. From fairest creatures we desire increase, that thereby beauty's rose might never die, but as the riper should by time decease, his tender air might bear his memory. But thou, contracted to thine own bright eyes, feast thy light's flame with self-substantial fuel, making a famine where abundance lies, thyself thy foe, to thy sweet self too cruel. Thou that art now the world's fresh ornament, and only herald to the gaudy spring, within thine own bud bearest thy content, and tender churl makes waste of niggarding. Pity the world, or else this glutton be, to eat the world's stew by the grave and thee. Sonnet 2. When 40 winters shall besiege thy brow, and dig deep trenches in thy beauty's field, thy youth's proud livery so gazed on now, will be a tottered weed of small worth held. Then being asked where all thy beauty lies, or all the treasure of thy lusty days, to say within thine own deep sunken eyes, when all aiding shame and thriftless praise, how much more praise deserved thy beauty's use, if thou couldst answer, this fair child of mine, shall sum my count and make my old excuse, proving his beauty by succession thine. 'Tis were to be new made when thou art old, to see thy blood warm when thou feel'st it cold. Sonnet 3. Look in the glass and tell the face thou viewest, now is the time that face should form another, whose fresh repair, if now thou wilt not renewest, thou dost beguile the world and bless some other. For where is she so fair whose unearned womb disdains the tillage of thy husbandry? For who he is, so fond will be the tomb of his self-love to stop posterity. Thou art thy mother's glass, and she in thee calls back the lovely April of her prime. So thou through windows of thine age shalt see, despite of wrinkles, this thy golden time. But if thou live, rememberest not to be, die single, and thine image dies with thee. Sonnet 4. Unthrifty loveliness, why dost thou spend upon thyself thy beauty's legacy? Nature's bequest gives nothing but doth lend, and being frank, she lends to those are free. Then, beauteous niggard, why dost thou abuse the bounteous largess given thee to give. Profitless usurer, why dost thou use so great a sum of sums, yet canst not live? For having traffic with thyself alone, of thyself thy sweet self doth deceive. Then how, when nature calls thee to be gone, what acceptable audit canst thou leave? Thy unused beauty must be tombed with thee, which used lives the executioner to be. Sonnet 5. Those hours that with gentle work did frame the lovely gaze where every eye doth dwell, will play the tyrants to the very same, and that unfair which fairly doth excel. For never resting, time leads summer on to hideous winter, and confounds him there, sap checked with frost, and lusty leaves quite gone, beauty o'ersnowed, and bareness everywhere. Then were not summer's distillation left a liquid prisoner pent in walls of glass? Beauty's effect with beauty were bereft, nor it, nor no remembrance that it was, but flowers distilled, though they with winter met, they sped their show, their substance still of sweet. Sonnet 6. Then not let winter's ragged hand deface in thee thy summer, ere thou be distilled. Make sweet some vial, treasure thou some place with beauty's treasure, ere it be self-killed. That use is not forbidden usury, which happies those that pay the willing loan, that for thyself to breed another thee, or 10 times happier, be it 10 for one. 10 times thyself were happier than thou art, if 10 of thine 10 times refigured thee. Then what could death do if thou shouldst depart, leaving thee in posterity? Be not self-willed, for thou art much too fair to be death's conquest and make worms thy heir. Sonnet 7. Lo, in the orient, when the gracious light lifts up his burning head, each under eye doth homage to his new appearing sight, serving with looks his sacred majesty, and having climbed the steeped up heavenly hill, resembling strong youth in his middle age, yet mortal looks adore his beauty still, attending on his golden pilgrimage. And when from highmost pitch with weary car, like feeble age, he reeleth from the day, the eyes for duteous now converted are from his low track, and look another way. So thou thyself outgoing in thy noon, unlookest on die, unless thou get a son. Sonnet 8. Music to hear. Why hearest thou music sadly? Sweets with sweets war not, joy delights in joy. Why lovest thou that which thou receivest not gladly? Or else receivest with pleasure thine annoy? By unions married do offend thine ear. They do but sweetly chide thee who confounds in singleness the parts that thou shouldst bear. Mark how one string, sweet husband to another, strikes each and each by mutual ordering, resembling sire and child and happy mother, who all in one pleasing note do sing, whose speechless song, being many, seeming one, sings this to thee, thou single wilt prove none. Sonnet 9. Sonnet 9. Is it for fear to wed a widow's eye that thou consumest thyself in a single day? Ah, if thou issueless shalt have to die, the world will wail thee like a makeless wife. The world will be thy widow and still weep that thou no form of thee hast left behind, when every private widow well may keep by children's eyes her husband's shape in mind. Look what an unthrift in the world doth spend, shifts but his place, for still the world enjoys it. But beauty's waste hath in the world an end, and kept unused, the user so destroys it. No love towards others in that bosom sits, that on himself such murderous shame commits. For shame deny that thou bearest love to any, who for thyself art so improvident. Grant, if thou wilt, thou art beloved of many, that thou none lovest is more evident, for thou art so possessed with murderous hate, against thyself thou stickest not to conspire, seeking that beauteous roof to ruinate, which to repair should be thy chief desire. O change thy thought, that I may change my mind. Shall hate be fairer lodged than gentle love? Be as thy presence is, gracious and kind, or to thyself at least kind-hearted prove. Make thee another self for love of me, that beauty still may live in thine or thee. Sonnet 11. As fast as thou shalt wane, so fast thou growest, in one of thine, from that which thou departest, and that fresh blood which youngly thou bestowest, thou mayest call thine when from youth convertest. Herein lies wisdom, beauty, and increase. Without this, folly, age, and cold decay. If all were minded so, the time should cease, and 80 years would make the world away. Let loose whom nature hath not made for store, harsh featureless and rude, barrenly perish. Look whom she best endowed, and give the more, which bounteous gift thou shouldst in bounty cherish. She carved for thee her seal, and meant thereby, thou shouldst print more, not let that copy die. Sonnet 12. When I do count the clock that tells the time, and see the brave day sunk in hideous night, when I behold the violet past prime, and sable curls all silvered o'er with white, when lofty trees I see barren of leaves, which erst from heat did canopy the herd, summer's green, all girded up in sheaves, borne on the bier with white and bristly beard, then of thy beauty do I question make, that thou among the waste of time must go, since sweets and beauties do themselves forsake, and die as fast as they see others grow, and nothing gainst time's scythe can make defense, save breed to brave him when he takes thee hence. Sonnet 13. Oh, that thou wert thyself. Oh, that you were yourself. But love, you are no longer yours, than you yourself here live. Against this coming end, you should prepare, and your sweet sibilance to some other give. So should that beauty which you hold in lease find no determination when you were, your yourself again after yourself's decease, when your sweet issue your sweet form should bear. Who let so fair a house fall to decay, when husbandry and honor might uphold, against the stormy gusts of winter's day, and barrage rage of death's eternal cold. Oh, none but unthrifts, dear my love. You know, you had a father, let your son say so. Sonnet 14. Not from the stars do I my judgment pluck, and yet methinks I have astronomy, but not to tell of good or evil luck, of plagues, of dearths, or season's quality. Nor can I of fortune two brief minutes tell, pointing to each his thunder, rain, and wind, or say with princes if it goes well, or say with princes if it shall go well, by oft predict that I in heaven find. But from thine eyes my knowledge I derive, and constant stars in them I read such art, as truth and beauty shall together thrive, if from thyself to store thou wouldst convert, or else of thee this I prognosticate, thy end is truth's and beauty's doom and date. Sonnet 15. When I consider everything that grows holds in perfection but a little moment, that this huge stage presenteth not but shows, whereupon the stars in secret influence comment, when I perceive that men as plants increase, cheered and checked even by the selfsame sky, vaunt in their youthful sap that height decrease, and wear their brave state out of memory, then the conceit of this inconstant stay sets you most rich in youth before my sight, where wasteful time debateth with decay, to change your days of youth to sullied night, and all in war with time for love of you, as he takes from you, I engraft you new. Sonnet 16. But wherefore do you not a mightier way make war upon this bloody tyrant time, and fortify yourself in your decay with means more blessed than my barren rhyme? Now stand you on the top of happy hours, and many maiden gardens yet unset, with virtuous wish would bear your living flowers, much liker than your painted counterfeit. So should the lines of life that life repair, which this time's pencil or my pupil pen, neither an inward youth nor outward fair, can make you live yourself in eyes of men. To give away yourself keeps yourself still, and you must live, drawn by your own sweet skill. Sonnet 17. Who would believe my verse in time to come, if it were filled with your most high deserts? Though yet, heaven knows, it is but as a tomb, which hides your life and shows not half your parts. If I could write the beauty of your eyes, and in fresh numbers number all your graces, the age to come would say, this poet lies, such heavenly touches ne'er touched earthly faces. So should my papers, yellowed with their age, be scorned, like old men of less truth than tongue, and your true rights be termed a poet's rage, and stretched meter of an antique song. But were some children of yours alive that time, you should love twice, in it and in my rhyme. Sonnet 18. Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds do shake the darling buds of May, and summer's lease hath all too short a date. Sometimes too hot the eye of heaven shines, and often is his gold complexion dimmed, and every fair from fair sometimes declines, by chance or nature's changing course untrimmed. But thy eternal summer shall not fade, nor lose possession of that fair thou owest, nor shall death brag thou wanderest in his shade, when in eternal lines to time thou growest. So long as men can breathe or eyes can see, so long lives this, and this gives life to thee. Sonnet 19. Devouring time, blunt thou the lion's paws, and make the earth devour her own sweet brood. Pluck the keen teeth from the fierce tiger's jaws, and burn the long-lived phoenix in her blood. Make glad and sorry seasons as thou fleet'st, and do whate'er thou wilt, swift-footed time. To the wide world and all her fading sweets, but I forbid thee one most heinous crime. O, carve not with thy hours my love's fair brow, nor draw no lines where thine antique pen him in thy course untainted do allow, for beauty's pattern to succeeding men. Yet do thy worst, old time, despite thy wrong. My love shall in my verse ever live young. Sonnet 20. A woman's face, with nature's own hand painted, hast thou, the master mistress of my passion. A woman's gentle heart, but not acquainted with shifting change, as is false women's fashions. An eye more bright than theirs, less false and rolling, gilding the object whereupon it gazeth. A man in hue, all hues in his controlling, which steals men's eyes and women's souls amazeth. And for a woman wert thou first created, tell nature, as she wrought thee, fell to doting, and by addition me of thee defeated, by adding one thing to my purpose nothing. But since she pricketh thee out for woman's pleasure, mine be thy love, and thy loves use their treasure. Sonnet 21. So it is not with me as with that muse, stirs by a painted beauty to his verse, who heaven itself for ornament doth use, and every fair with his fair doth rehearse, making a couplement of proud compare with sun and moon and earth and sea's rich gems, with April's firstborn flowers and all things rare, that heaven's air is in this huge wanderer hymns. Yet let me, true in love, but truly write, and then believe me, my love is as fair as any mother's child, though not so bright, as those gold candles fixed in heaven's airs. Let them say more than that, like of hearsay well. I will not praise that purpose not to sell. Sonnet 22. My glass shall not persuade me, I am old. My glass shall not persuade me, I am old. So long as youth and thou art of one date, but when in thee time's froze I behold, then look I death my day should expiate. For all that beauty that doth hover thee is but the seemly raiment of my heart, which in my breast doth live as thine and me. How can I then be elder than thou art? O, therefore, love, be of thyself so wary, as I not for myself but for thee will, bearing thy heart, which I will keep so chary as tender nurse her babe from faring ill. Presume not on thy heart when mine is slain, thou gav'st me thine, not give back again. Sonnet 23. As an imperfect actor on the stage, who with his fear is put besides his part, or some fierce thing replete with too much rage, whose strength's abundance weakens his own heart, so I, for fear of trust, forget to say the perfect ceremony of love's rite, and in mine own love's strength seem to decay, or charged with burthen of mine own love's might. Oh, let my books be then the eloquence and dumb presagers of my speaking breast, who plead for love and look for recompense, more than that tongue that more hath more expressed. To hear with eyes belongs to love's fine wit. Sonnet 24. Mine eyes hath played painter and hath stelled thy beauty's form in table of mine heart. My body is the frame wherein 'tis held, in perspective it is best painter's art. For through the painter must you see his skill, to find where your true image pictured lies, which in my bosom shop is hanging still, that hath his windows glazed with thine eyes. Now see what good turn eyes for eyes have done. Mine eyes have drawn thy shape and thine for me, are windows to my breast, where through the sun delights to peep, to gaze wherein only. Yet eyes thus cunning want to grace their art, they draw but what they see, know not the heart. Sonnet 25. Let those who are in favor with their stars of public honor and proud titles boast, whilst I, whom fortune of such triumph bars, unlooked for joy in that I honor most. Great princes' favorites their fair leaves spread, but as the marigold at the sun's eye, and in themselves their pride lies buried, for at a frown they in their glory die. Painful warrior, famous for a fight, after 1,000 victories once foiled, is from the book of honor raised quite, and all the rest forgot for which he toiled. Then happy I that love and am beloved, where I may not remove nor be removed.